Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to the First Parish of Stow and Acton, a welcoming and inclusive Unitarian Universalist congregation. And I'd like to call us into our time of worship this morning with some words from the Reverend Dr. Barbara Holmes. She writes, "The theology of jazz is a blue note unsung. It's the plea to let there be some light, some dark, some love. It's the synchronicity of movements, because the walls do fall and the poor do rise. And the theology of jazz reminds us to breathe as we struggle, to remember the fallen, to rise on impossibilities. I wish it were otherwise, but it's the only way to break injustice once and for all. The theology of jazz is the theme song of the big mamas and other mothers who would take nothing for the journey now, and the papas and daddies who worked extra shifts so that we can rise. The theology of jazz is a story untold. It's the remnant of all that's good and all that's broken and all that we don't understand. I hope you know it's all up to us. I know it can be confusing because the translation is simultaneous. It's a secret. Don't tell anybody. The revolution will not be televised. It will be blown through a saxophone. Hear and be healed."
Something sacred in your heart. sing to me. Some little song or song, someone to take my heart and give his heart to me. Someone who's ready to give love a start with me. Oh yes, that would be so nice. Shouldn't be you and me, I can see it would be nice.
If you like music, this is the place for you. We are really a musically blessed parish with all our varieties of music that take place both during the year and in the summer as well. We truly have a wonderful and a varied music program where lots and lots of people contribute their talents. Music is unquestionably very important to us at First Parish. But the importance of music and worship is nothing new. And although our Puritan forebears, including those right here in this church, banished all instruments from worship for a time, music making has been an intricate part of most worship for thousands of years. Moses' sister, Miriam, is credited with being the first choir director. In the Exodus story, it's reported that she led the Hebrew women in song celebrating the successful crossing of the Red Sea. Although we no longer know the original tunes, we do know the Psalms were written some 3,000 years ago and were intended to be sung with instruments. The markings are in the text. And they were intended to be sung when people gather, just as we do this morning. And some of the hymns that we still sing, a few of them, date back as much as 1,000 years. I really think it's difficult to even think of church without some music playing in my head, and probably in yours too. It may be something from the past with a particular kind of sound. Perhaps for you it's Gregorian chant or polyphony, or the sounds of a German chorale of Bach's time, or maybe one of the contemporary hymns from our hymnal, like the one we sang earlier in this service. Perhaps you associate the classical music of long-dead white men with church, and surely all that music is part of our past and continues to enrich our program here, but the traditions of the past are not where we stop. The musicians and poets who wrote the Psalms knew there would always be new inspiration to create music that connect us in that deep place of meaning making. In our tradition, we acknowledged long ago that there is not just one type of music that we call sacred, that we listen to when we come together, that we participate in. We know that all kinds of music have the power to touch the soul, and we welcome those sounds in our times of worship. You know, the psalmist tells us not just to make a joyful noise, but interestingly, also to sing a new song and to gather all our instruments to make our music. In every time and in every different place, the new music of the soul draws on what has come before and adds to it the musical language of its own time and culture. And perhaps nowhere is that more true than in the music of jazz. I'm grateful to have our jazz band joining us, and although their music certainly speaks for itself, I'd like to take a little time to reflect a bit on this type of music called jazz. In jazz, we surely see the energy and the vitality of a culture represented. The jazz world is not serene, not perfectly ordered, and hierarchically organized. It is not a world where all is dogmatically given, written in stone. Jazz reflects a world where there is tension. There are obstacles, there are limitations and struggles and ambiguity. It's a world where both individualism and community are important. One that exists on a level playing field where leadership moves from one person to another. And there's also a transcendent element, a spirit that moves in the music that leads the players to go beyond the expected. Through the power of creative interchange, by the way, a phrase that one Unitarian Universalist theologian used to describe or define the God term, the whole comes together as much more than the sum of the parts. Not pre-planned by any one person, but evolving through the interaction of the members of a radically equal and committed community. If all that sounds familiar to you, it's because jazz is a powerful metaphor for liberal religious community and indeed for liberal theology itself. Tom Stites expressed in an article in the UU World Magazine a few years ago, "This music," referring to jazz, "and this religion," referring to Unitarian Universalism, "not all religion, but our specific religion, resonates on a remarkable number of levels." So this morning, I would like to explore some of those levels of resonance with you. Several years ago, I went with a couple of other people from the church to a mid-sized church conference in Kansas City. The focus of the workshop was on building and strengthening our congregation and developing leadership. But the means through which the topic was approached was jazz. There we sat in a large hall ready for the first probably boring lecture, and instead, an incredible jazz band began to play. I actually think we felt a little guilty, perhaps thinking we were supposed to be there for more serious work. However, from time to time, the performers were interrupted by well-known theologian Sharon Welch, who interviewed members of the band about just what they were doing when they played jazz. In a nutshell, this is what they said. First of all, they were listening, actually listening with respect for the contributions their colleagues were making. Second, they were willing to take risks in order to explore new territory. When they played, they didn't simply repeat what someone else did, but they didn't dismiss it or ignore it either. Instead, they built on it. Third, players would step forward in the band and put their individual mark on a piece, but then step back to support someone else emerging as a leader. Similarly, the author Tom Piazza in the Guide to Classically Recorded Jazz observed, in a jazz group, as in any community, certain roles need to be fulfilled. Someone has to play the melody. Someone has to keep time. Someone has to suggest the harmonic content. In jazz, each instrument has to understand his or her role well enough so that he or she can improvise on it and not just follow directions. Playing in a jazz group involves both responsibility and freedom. Freedom consists of understanding your responsibility well enough to act independently and still make the needed contribution to the group. As such, a jazz performance is a working model of democracy. Well, back to that conference for a minute. You may ask, as some folks did at that conference, what's all this have to do with mid-sized Unitarian Universalist churches? After all, we're not musicians attending a jazz workshop. But think about it for a moment. What is required of leadership in a liberal mid-sized congregation is the very same thing that makes for a successful jazz band. Lots of listening, good democratic process where at times we're all leaders and all followers, and respectfully building upon what others have done rather than just slavishly repeating the same thing. But there's more to the comparison between jazz and liberal religion than just social organization or community building techniques. There is much in jazz which theologically can describe who we are as Unitarian Universalists. First, both jazz and Unitarian Universalist theology share a willingness to enter new territory. In theological terms, we would probably say revelation is not closed. Like a jazz musician, we're willing to go where the path leads and also willing to support others who venture on their independent search for truth and meaning that may well not be the same as ours. Indeed, we are an improvisational faith. Now, some groups might consider that a weak theology. Perhaps in the same way some would devalue jazz as an art form because it doesn't have every note carefully written on the page like a Bach prelude, and it's not judged for its quality of performance by how closely the performer comes to reproducing exactly what's on the page. It takes courage to have an improvisational faith as opposed to a doctrinal one. A person must take responsibility for the religious convictions they hold. Neither jazz nor Unitarian Universalism are for those unwilling to take some risk. Neither is for the faint-hearted. For those who explore liberal theology, as well as for jazz musicians, a solid foundation is in fact required before you embark on the journey. In the words of one jazz musician, you have to have a strong sense of what's already been laid down. We build on the great teachings that have come before us, not rejecting them, but opening them up, mining them for new meaning in our times. As part of that expanded view, as part of our commitment to know what's already been laid down, we do draw inspiration from a variety of sources. No sources are off limits. Avenues to the sacred are certainly found in the Bible or the Quran or other great religious books, but they're also found in poets and secular writers, and especially in our own life experience. Gospel, blues, and jazz come from a synthesis of cultures, not from a rejection of one for the superiority of another. There is not one score, not one holy book, but many, and revision, elaboration, and radical interpretation and reinterpretation are not some kind of hierarchical affront or heretical affront, but they are welcomed and they are actually expected. Unitarian Universalist theology, like jazz, is radically inclusive and never exclusive. But as in jazz, when we come together in all our diversity, there will be, in fact, some tension, some dissonance even. In Tom Stite's words, liberal religion rests on the theological premise that by coming together with all our differences, we can summon the holy. The theologian Cornel West, in his book Race Matters, writes, "Jazz is an improvisational mode suspicious of either-or viewpoints, dogmatic pronouncements, or supremacist ideologies. The interplay of individuality and unity is not one of uniformity and unanimity. It's imposed from above, but rather a conflict among diverse groups that reach a dynamic consensus subject to questioning and criticism. As with a soloist, with a jazz band, individuality is promoted in order to sustain and create creative tension within the group, a tension that yields higher levels of performance to achieve the aim of the collective project. The community is important indeed, but so too is the highest fulfillment of the individual. The balance between individualism and community, so essential to good jazz, has been and continues to be a healthy tension that we as Unitarian Universalists have embraced in our theology now for centuries. Make no mistake, ours is not a self-centered theology. When we move beyond dogmatic pronouncements, our supremacist ideologies, to embrace the tension and conflict in our theology, we make rich theological music which transcends old boundaries and opens us up to new ways of seeing God, seeing the sacred, or seeing our world. A jazz theology focuses on expanding yourself while living in right relationship with others. And you know, there's also a very spiritual or pastoral side to jazz which we should not overlook. From its inception, jazz has always expressed hope triumphing over oppression. As a musical form which had its earliest roots in this nation's slaves, which flourished in the shameful days of segregation, it was not just a critique of the injustice of American society, but a powerful affirmation of hope. Jazz can minister to our souls when we hurt or are trapped by our perceived limitations. Sometimes in jazz, we can transcend our limitations, but equally important from the jazz model is that we can learn to flourish within our limitations. You know, when asked how he composed music, Duke Ellington once expressed that since his trumpet player could reach certain notes beautifully but not other notes, and the same be said for his trombonist, he had to write his music within those limits. "It's good to have limits," he remarked. Jazz is there to teach us the infinite and variety and beauty possible within our own present limitations. The jazz pianist, Mary Lou Williams, would stop playing and quiet her noisy club audience by saying, "Just listen, this can heal you." Jazz speaks to us in times of personal challenge. In listening to jazz, we hear the dissonance and the conflict of our own lives, but there is also reconciliation, resolution, and transcendence. When Sharon Welch was asked why she used the jazz metaphor in theology, she replied, "Because I've learned from jazz to hear the world differently. I've learned from jazz how to work with limits and opportunities, possibilities and ambiguities, obstacles and challenges. I see in jazz a model of meaning, a model of responsiveness without progress or repetition, without self-abnegation or self-righteousness. When I hear jazz, I often sense oppression and struggle being lifted and then released. Jazz is about this kind of transformation. Listening to jazz can be an experience of the holy, an experience that I would call one of grace. Not easy grace, but the grace that rises out of that sense of some struggle and some pain, some tension. The Unitarian Universalist theologian James Luther Adams could well have been thinking of jazz when he wrote these words. With a special sense of immediacy and inwardness, music redefines, illumines, refreshes, and orders our experience. It is not an escape from reality. It is rather the rediscovery of a center of meaning and power, of a center that is a symptom and a sign of faith. Ultimately, not a human achievement, but a gift of grace. And as we've heard this morning, how sweet is that sound?
Thank you. Thank you.